Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about cash and receivables, our most liquid accounts. We've talked about how to control cash and reduce the likelihood of theft, and then we focused most of our attention for the last couple sessions on accounts receivable, the basics of making those initial journal entries, how we record repayments, and then how we record net receivables and adjust for the fact that some people are going to rip us off. Now that we've got those basics done, it's time to talk about notes receivable. Now, we've talked about the differences between accounts and notes receivable already, but as a quick refresher, remember that notes receivable are more formal. They usually have a longer term, they usually charge interest, and they usually have a more formal contract. Because they're over a longer period of time, we have to account for notes receivable at their present value. And hopefully you're already comfortable with the basics of time value of money. If you are, then we can just continue on. If you're not, there is another segment out there that talks about time value, and you might want to take a few minutes to be comfortable with those concepts before you go on with these. The basic idea here is that when we offer somebody money today for money that they're going to repay us later, they have to pay us for the fact that we won't have the money for a period of time. They have to pay us for the risk that they're going to default and not pay us back, and they have to pay us for the fact that buying power will reduce. So $100 today buys much less than $100 10, 15 years ago, just because of inflation. So what we're trying to do when we record our notes receivable is adjust for those three pieces: inflation, risk, and the fact that we don't have the money to invest ourselves. In our financial statements, we're going to record a net amount, the amount that we really think that's worth after we account for those three main factors. Now, if you have done time value, chances are you've done it in the context of loans, not as receivables. So you've been doing journal entries or accounting for the fact that we issue debt and then we have to repay it. So you've done it from the point of view of the person who took out the loan. Now we're going to shift and talk about the calculations and the journal entries if you're the person who has loaned the money and expects to get it back in the future. So let's take a look at the key concepts and key ideas and values that we need to know in order to do these journal entries. First is the face amount, and the face amount is what it says on the contract. So if we were to draw out our loan document, the amount that it shows on there that we have to repay, that's the face amount. The next is what we call the stated rate, and again, this is in the contract. It's the percentage that the contract says we are going to pay. Chances are in the contract it says, and you will pay terms of 4% interest or 5% interest or whatever it is. That's a stated rate. The next is what we call the effective rate, and this is what the market thinks we should be paying. So you'll also see this called the market rate. It'll be called the effective rate, or sometimes it's our internal rate of return. There's lots of terms for this idea, but it's the present value factor. This is what we think. If we add up the interest rate we think we should be getting to adjust for risk, the inflation factor, the inconvenience factor, we add all those up, that's what this interest rate is. And we call it the effective rate is because that's what we're going to use effectively when we do our time value calculations. So that's the effective rate. The next is present value, and this is what that future cash is worth in today dollars. That's our present value, hence the term present is what is it worth today in the present. Next is the discount and premium, and the easiest way to think about discount and premium is actually to think about football tickets, believe it or not. And now I admit right up front, I don't know much about football. I'm not a football fan. I know that's probably a little bit of blasphemy from a college professor, but I'm just not good at it. I have finally figured out that all the players have different numbers, and the goal is to get past the second to the end line on the field. I'm not sure why they're not going all the way to the end, but they only go to the second to the last line. And if they can do that without getting killed, then they get however many points are on the back of their jersey. What I haven't figured out is why they don't give the quarterback numbers like 115, 200. I mean, if they're going to get the points on the jersey, they might as well make the points. I'm kidding. I'm not really that bad. I'm bad, but I'm not that bad. Anyway, think about all the football tickets in the world for all the different games, and let's pretend that the tickets for each one are $100. Now, thinking about that, would you be willing to pay a little extra to get tickets to the Super Bowl? Probably, right? Because it's the best game of the season and supposedly the two best teams and all that, and it's a unique experience. That's a premium. When you're willing to pay more than the dollar amount, you're willing to pay a premium to get it. Now, with a discount, it's a little bit different. With a discount, what we're basically asking is, would you be willing to pay the full $100 to a team like University of Idaho that never wins a game or only occasionally wins a game? Would you be willing to pay $100 for a team to go see a team like that? And the answer is no, probably not, because the game isn't going to be as good, there's not the name recognition, etc. When you're not willing to pay the full amount that it states it's worth, that's a discount. That's what we're talking about. And the same thing holds true for debt. See, if you think they should be paying 10% and they're only offering 5%, you're not going to give them $100,000. You're not going to loan them that much. I could go somewhere else and earn 8 or 10%. So why would I give it to you? Now, I might give you $80,000 and you can pay me the 5% and then the full $100,000 at the end. So I'll pay $80,000 now for $100,000 later. Yeah, I might do that. That's a discount. Same thing with the premium. You're offering 15%. I think you should be offering 10%. Wow, this is a great deal for me. I'll pay a little extra to get all that extra interest. That's a premium from a decision-making point of view. From an accounting point of view, when you pay that money, whether you pay a little extra as a premium to get that bond or whether you pay a little less as a discount, that goes onto our books. And what we end up seeing, here's the actual face value of the loan, and that's what they're going to pay us when the loan comes due. If there's a premium, we record this much on our books. And between here and there, we have to get rid of that premium. If there's a discount, then we start down here. We take that face value, we subtract to get to what we actually paid. And again, we've got to get it, that line's not as nice and neat, we've got to get it up to that amount. So we're going to slowly get rid of that discount or premium over the life of the loan that we've made. Now the next concept here is called carrying value. And the carrying value is what we show on our books at any given time. So that would be this amount, or this amount, or this amount, and eventually it will be this face value amount. That's what the carrying value is. It's the face value plus the premium, or minus the discount. Next is amortization. And amortization, we've already conceptually talked about this, but now it's got a formal name. Amortization is the process of getting from this original value down to that fair value. It's all these little tick marks where we get rid of some of that premium or get rid of some of that discount. That's amortization. And we've got two ways that we can do this. One is the straight line method, where we just take that whole amount, that whole premium or that whole discount, and we divvy it up equally over the life of this loan that we've made. Effective interest rate, a little bit different. We base it on the market rate, and we record a little bit more interest or a little bit less interest each period than we're actually getting, and we use that to slowly get us to that face value. Before we wrap up this bit of a discussion, let me just say, this idea that we record things at what we pay for them, and that's either going to cause a premium or a discount that then has to be amortized away over the life of the loan so that we start with what we actually paid for and we end with what we're going to get, that's a key concept in dealing with notes receivable. And we're going to do some examples here in a bit that'll hopefully solidify it, but just be aware, that's really key to being able to understand and do these effectively. Now, we've talked about a lot of conceptual stuff with notes receivable, and hopefully it's made sense. But in our next segment, we'll start doing some journal entries, yes, and some calculations that hopefully will help to solidify all of this. I'll see you then.